really wonderful. We have Professor Jaya Chakravarti, and she is the head of the Department of Medicine, Institute of Medical Sciences, Banaras Hindu University. She was the nodal officer for COVID during the first wave, and continues to be the in charge of post-COVID OPD. She's also very actively involved as we are going through this particular wave and we have a surge of cases. She has deep interest and body of work on infectious diseases, which includes leishmaniasis, HIV, and she continues with that interest even now. But due to the COVID, she is in charge of, she is at the helm of affairs for a lot of activities due to COVID. We also have Professor Sangeeta Kansal, who was the formerly head of the Department of Community Medicine, Institute of Medical Sciences, Banaras Hindu University, and Madam is the quarantine in charge at BHU. So I take this opportunity to welcome Jaya Ma'am and Sangeeta Madam, of course, and there shall be an informal interaction, and we shall try and explore some aspects of COVID-19 pandemic as we go through this wave, which looks very massive at the moment. And let us try and see what public health aspects we could explore during our discussions, ma'am. So mostly this will be an experiential kind of conversation. Ma'am, you have been handling COVID cases. Last year, you were in charge. You were the nodal officer and then went on to the post-COVID OPDs. And there is a gamut of comorbidities and risk factors that people would present with. What are your experiences with non-communicable diseases, let us say hypertension or diabetes or any other condition, as a risk factor for COVID-19 during the past wave, and do you see any differences now?
Okay, thanks Achisman for inviting me, number one. So last year, of course, everybody knows that the patients with comorbidity have severe disease, and especially comorbidity like obesity, diabetes, COPD, CKD, patients who are elderly and already debilitated, like having stroke or dementia and cancer, everybody knows that. As for hypertension, because there's a lot of focus on hypertension in this talk, so hypertension per se is a possible risk. But, you know, most of the risk I've told you, like hypertension is associated with elderly, it is associated with the obesity, with diabetes, with CKD. So if you just take that way, hypertension is at a big risk. Last year also, patients with comorbidity were having more severe disease. But this year, even the comorbidity, patient with comorbidity has a higher risk. But this year, there's a little bit change. Even patients who are younger without comorbidity are coming with severe disease. And the reason could be that many of the patients with comorbidity may have been vaccinated. So, and it is very, very true that those who have been vaccinated are having mild disease, whether they have comorbidity or not. That is my experience this side. Anybody who's taken the two doses of vaccine, even if they're obese and hypertensive and all, they're doing much, much better. So, this is my take in the matter. And last year, we did not see so many young people coming, but this year we have a whole lot of young people, and I've seen young people dying too. So this is my experience for comorbidity as well as COVID in general.
Are we getting these fillers from different parts of the country? Because I've been talking to some of my friends elsewhere also, and sort of similar picture across our country. Ma'am, what is your take on the state of awareness among people? Do they already know that they are hypertensive or diabetic when they present to you? Or is it a first-time diagnosis that they get under your care, especially in Banaras?
A whole lot of people never check their blood pressure. And many people just come with non-specific findings and then we just check the blood pressure and they are hypertensive. So the awareness is not good, especially among uneducated. Like we are a government hospital. We have a lot of patients from the lower socioeconomic group as well as the lower middle socioeconomic group. So most of them are unaware. And when we check, only then we find that they are hypertensive. Even if they are hypertensive, and they know that they are hypertensive, they don't take their drugs because they think ab control ho gaya to chhod dena hai. Okay, and they don't have the concept that once it is controlled by a drug, you have to continue that drug. And many of the, I think, because we are so busy in the OPD, we are not communicating the right thing that if you are hypertensive, this is almost a lifelong treatment. You have to continue. If you don't continue, you're going to have so many problems. You can be down with a stroke or an MI or whatever it is. So we need to communicate. So I think awareness and communication to patients, it is low and needs to be improved.
Sangeeta ma'am, I'll come to you on this because this is a picture that ma'am is suggesting from a tertiary care setup, and of course you know the community. Do you see another kind of gap in terms of awareness or diagnosis or even treatment referral mechanism? What is your take on this part of our country?
Especially I think in the rural community, there is a wide gap between the awareness, the diagnosis, the treatment, and the control treatment. It's a huge gap and showing a cascade effect. I think more than 50% is not aware of that they are having hypertension. And out of that 50%, they are on treatment. They are difficulty in getting treatment, poor accessibility, poor availability of the full treatment, qualified doctors, and out of those treated in the hospitals or health centers, only 50% are, their hypertension is controlled. And out of those 50%, more than 50%, their hypertension is adequately controlled. They are receiving adequate treatment. It's not the full treatment. So there's a huge gap and we have to address this gap. The research is required on this gap analysis, and it's I think it's the most need of the hour to address this area, to raise the awareness and the control hypertension.
So it's kind of a continuum. So
you
were tertiary care, and now we have COVID also, and they go back with some morbidities due to COVID, and they need to follow up. So two debatable aspects here. I'll come to Jaya ma'am here. So
can I add something into it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Due to the multiple lockdowns and increase in case, and we went from OPD to telemedicine, a whole lot of our follow-up patients, they could not get access to us. And they were quite confused what to do because we have written 2 months drug and they were supposed to come back and they did not come. They left their drugs. That also created a whole lot of problems for a lot of people. So they did not know what to do, whether to continue that drug or leave it. So the disruption of the medical services due to this COVID pandemic has been a big challenge for a patient with chronic disease, whether it is hypertension, diabetes, or any of the chronic diseases. It has been a huge challenge.
So in this case, some solutions, no? Some innovations or some suggestions as a recommendation or something that we could take forward from this learning?
See, telemedicine is a help, huge help. But everybody is not that smart that they can get access to telemedicine services. So I think simple phone, and if we give the phone numbers in the papers, ki ye ye din ye ye doctors baithenge, ye unka phone number hai, is phone number pe aap phone karenge to sampark kar sakte hain. That will make life easier for the patients. So in BHO, they have started the phone services. They just need to disseminate that information and put it in websites and put it in papers so that everybody gets to know, because BHU gets a lot of patients from a lot of other places, not from local Varanasi. They get from nearby districts. So that is one solution. Maybe we can do that.
I just fully agree with Dr. Jaya, but this is during COVID. Okay. Actually, in a routine programmatic condition, what is required is a strengthening of the health system. Like Dr. Jaya said, it's a special arrangement for telemedicine, is a special arrangement for COVID. But what is the need of the hour is at our rural health centers, or right from the sub-center to the CSC, patient should be counseled. You have to take the drugs lifelong. And these are the drugs, antihypertensive drugs. So it should be the route. Yeah.
I think besides drugs, actually, you... what we don't concentrate upon is lifestyle modification.
That is in addition.
How you exercise, this is very important. When hypertension, diabetes, if you don't give lifestyle modification to the, don't tell them very clearly, these are the lifestyle modification, you should do it. I think that is only half of the treatment if you just give drugs and send the patient back.
So actually, Dr. Jaya, this cluster condition is very common, this hypertension and diabetes. And in our hospital also, we are running the pre-diabetes clinic. So we can similar take the example and we can do this pre-hypertensive clinics also. Those who are pre-hypertensive, we can do the lifestyle management or the diet management. So we can start at our rural health centers also. Because in urban areas, people can access the hospitals, the clinic, the private clinics, and aware also.
Most of our urban hospitals are also very crowded. It is also the amount of time I give you. See, you come and I give you only 2 minutes or 3 minutes, I just see the blood pressure and just say, dawa khao. It doesn't matter. The patient does not get it in his system. I have to do lifestyle modification plus dawa and have to continue it for lifelong. You have to counsel the patient. That is very, very important.
Actually, it's a teamwork. You need dietitian, you need yoga personnel, you need the data manager. It's a teamwork. And it's possible only during the pre-hypertensive clinics. It's not possible during this OPD. You can do the only curative part, the management.
One aspect is about getting people to a usual lifestyle, a normal healthy lifestyle with some lifestyle But we also touched upon access issues. What about those people who have been diagnosed already and need medications? There was much discussion about advanced prescriptions. So we give drugs in advance for a couple of months, maybe 2 months, 3 months, and we think that that will help. What are your takes on this, Jaya ma'am?
I definitely think you should, patients who are actually very controlled, well-controlled, hypertensive, they should be given 3 months prescription fine so that they don't have to come to busy OPDs. Because this period, COVID is not going to go fast, Dr. Sangeeta. So it is going to stay for at least 2-3 years and then there'll be waves and there'll be dip. Again, there'll be waves. Till we all get COVID and get immunized or get vaccinated, whatever it is. So at this point of time, I do think that patients who are unstable and they should be given 3 to 4 months of drugs so that they don't have to come back. And those patients who are unstable, there are certain labile hypertensives. They are like patients with CKD, with blood pressure problems. They always have blood pressure problems and it's very labile. Of course, they have to come back to the hospital. But they also should try and do it through telemedicine or through telephonic so that I don't want this patient to come to the OPD just for their, just to show their blood pressure, because a whole lot of things can be done at home. You can just do a home monitoring of blood pressure, and that is much, much better than your clinic monitoring of blood pressure. Because many patients, their blood pressure, when you just see their chart, what they've done at home, and they come to the clinic, they show, then I see the blood pressure in the clinic, there's a huge difference. They say, hospital mein aate hi badh jata hai, and it is true.
White coat.
So I think they should be taught how to look at their blood pressure, when to look at their blood pressure at home, and take a teleconsultation. If they have a labile hypertension, they need to increase or decrease their dose. And for those who are very stable hypertensive, they should be given 3 months. I think at this point of time, I think that is the best thing we can do for them.
Do we have really robust primary level treatment protocols for hypertension at the primary level? Do we need any capacity building around that? I guess there would be a gap.
Is that for me, Achasman, or for Sangeeta? Yeah.
I'm just thinking aloud.
Yes.
Sangeeta, that is for you.
Yes, 100%. 100%, Dr. Achasman. It's a huge gap. They are actually not aware, even I have experienced, they are not aware how to monitor blood pressure. You are asking about medicine. They are not aware of how to manage, taking blood pressure. Then management part is totally different. So first, when to say this hypertensive, what is the cutoff level, how to take blood pressure, what are the drugs required, and when to refer, how to refer. So these are certain issues needs to be addressed, and certainly will make a dent in the management of the hypertension.
So just one last question. There is a bit of controversy around use of ACE inhibitors. So I would like to comment on that.
Yeah. There's a lot of controversy because SARS, this virus uses ACE inhibitor as a entry receptor. But most guidelines and most studies have shown that people who are already on ACE inhibitor should not change it. It does not matter. So you should not change your antihypertensives. If you're taking ACE inhibitor, continue with the same. You do not need to change because there is a COVID pandemic going on. Whatever drug is controlling your hypertension, you should continue with that. But more important than that, I think the same line, I should again thrust upon vaccination and of course, prevention and avoiding gatherings. And this is a bad surge of COVID this year with lots and lots of patients getting involved. Previous year, even if one patient was involved, the other family members were not getting involved. This year, it is spreading much, much more. And I don't know why, but maybe we need to look into the strains, what is the difference with this strain, but the transmissibility definitely is much, much more this year. And I think the attitude is very lax this year. And that is one of the major reasons why there's a surge of cases. Last year, everybody was scared and everybody was taking precautions and we were in the preparatory stage. This year, though we are in the, we were already prepared, whatever preparation has been made is becoming less because of the surge of cases, because people have become very casual. I think we need to improve our awareness programs for COVID and protect ourselves very, very seriously.
So a quick concluding remarks from Jayamam, you and Sangeeta Madam also. So Jayamam, Madam, you are in charge of the post-COVID OPD also. What is your message for those who are recovering from COVID?
Most of the problems I had in my post-COVID OPD was with elderly. For young people, a lot of patients had mental issues. Because a whole lot of Dexona and steroids have been given, there is uncontrolled diabetes as well as hypertension in patients who are coming to the post-COVID OPD. And many of them are being diagnosed with new onset of hypertension and diabetes due to that. Besides this NCDs, other things like elderly are coming with atrial fibrillation, tachycardia. We've seen a lot of neurological, Bell's palsy, and even weakness and stroke after COVID. So there's a gamut of manifestations which we really need to document and give it to and circulate, actually, which can come with post-COVID. And of course, respiratory distress. Many patients we have diagnosed who never were RT-PCR positive, but had respiratory distress, and we just did an antibody levels, and the antibody levels were positive, and they had severe respiratory distress. So respiratory distress is one of the main post-COVID complications. And besides that, uncontrolled hypertension and diabetes is being very commonly seen in post-COVID OPDs. And of course, mental health issues, yes. Because it is so terrible to be in a COVID ward, especially those who have been in a COVID ward. It's a horrible thing to stay in a place where patients are dying in and out, and you come out of it, and I think it scars you mentally permanently.
Yeah. So that's a clear message for all those who are recovering from COVID. Please take care of your health. Don't just focus on your physical health, also your psychological health and some lifestyle modification. Coming to Sangeeta Madam, ma'am, the biggest controversy with COVID, quarantine, and you are leading that. Like, we had the first wave, so many news, so many different types of customization of quarantining processes. What is your take for this wave?
Actually, I'm looking after the quarantine of the health workers. So it's a guideline that you have to be in active quarantine during your COVID duty. So, and this year we are facing the issues of the patient's spouse or those who are posted in other places, that how to deal with it, because they are not getting leave for that. The husband is positive, the other family members are positive, and they are not getting leave for that. And there is no guideline for this also. So this year I am facing this problem. So, and I fully echo the statement of the given by Dr. Jaya as a take-home message. And I just would like to add the voice of the community that accessibility of the services is the main issue. Health services is the main issue. Irrespective is a elite class. They, of course, they can buy the services from the money. But the middle class, lower middle class, middle class is main issue is accessibility of the services. Knowledge about when to go, how to go, and where to go is the main issue. This is I am experiencing. I am getting calls for this, many calls, even from my research scholars, their family members. They are not aware that when to go, where to go. Everywhere is a limitation of the services. Hospital beds are not available. I should not say it's a poor preparation, but accessibility is the main issue during this phase, during this search.
Need to be more watchful. COVID-appropriate behaviors should be followed. As rightly has been pointed out, there is a bit of laxity. We are complacent. Mm-hmm. Accountability for following these cases. But whatever it is, we are into a bad spike in the number of cases. And let's just hope that we tide over this wave. Of course, subsequent waves would be there, but then vaccination is also on. Let's hope for the best. Thank you, Jaya ma'am. Thank you, Sangeeta madam. Wonderful interaction.
Yes. Thank you.